questions. I'm going to give you some information about the graph, so how to use the graph to generate to propagate the strand along the river network till the closer section, and then I'll show you the calibration, so using Luca. So by the end of today, you will be able to calibrate your parameters. So the program is that you are going to launch, if you want to try to launch your calibration during this night. So tomorrow in the morning we can see the results of the calibration, if you have a problem, and so on. Just to give you a really small introduction on the Net3, which is a great graph-based structure. It was developed by Francesco Serafin, who is a former PhD student of Professor Rivon. And so it is based on the analogy on the river network structure. So you can see that each of the sub-basins can be discretized as a point, which is in charge of the nodes of this graph. And the channels are the link between these nodes. So for example, in the case we are using the Cavone, we have 7 sub-basins, so 7 nodes. The closed section is the number 5, but I will show you that we are going to calibrate here, so that's the closed section 4, and then we are going to add the last node. Okay, so this is the topology file. You already saw this file. But in this case, it is customized on your river network. So basically, here you are defining how each node is flowing, the discharge generated in each of these nodes is connected to the downstream, to the closure section. So for example, here you are saying that node number 6 is going into node number 2, that node number 1 is flowing into node number 2. I can show you by the mouse. So node number 6 is going in number 2, and node number 1 is going to the number 2. So here you can see that 6 and 1 are going to number 2. Then we have that node number 2 is going to node number 3, node number 7 is going into node number 3. And then we have that node number 3 is going into node number 4. And then we have that node number 4 is our closer section. As I told you, I closed this network in the node number 4 because there we have the idle meter. But then if you want to simulate also node number 5, you have just to connect to the last node. So you can see here that there are different types of nodes. So we have nodes that node that can be processed in parallel, and are the outside node, let me call it like this. So it's number 6, number 1, and number 7. And then are the node number 2, in which we have the confluence of two nodes, so number 6 and number 1. And then we have a third type of node, which is the number 4, which is the closer section. So now we are going to analyze each of the sim files associated with this node, because we have to differentiate them. Okay, so first of all, this is the file containing the parameters that I showed you previously. So these are the parameters that were in the sim file 1_out. But this time you can put this parameter in a separate file that you can open in your project, is rm_params, which are exactly the same parameters with exactly the same name already defined in your sim file. Why? Because these parameters are set for the entire basin. So in your sim file, you can specify the parameters that are related to that sub-basin, to that HRU that you are simulating. But with this sim file, with this set of parameters, you are basically saying that all the sub-basins have the same set of parameters. Okay. And then there is a special sim file, which is the graph.sim, in which you define which file of parameters you are associating to each sub-basin, if you want to use the same set. This is important because if you want to perform a multi-site calibration, which means that you have different set of parameters for a group of HRUs, you can, for example, have two or three different parameters, file with parameters. So the graph.sim is organized as follows. So here you have to put the path to the files containing the topology, so topo.cavone.csv, and the path to the simulation folder where there are your .sim. Then here, you in this part of the sim file, you define which sub-basin. Okay, let me start from this part. So in the params file, you specify in the set of parameters. So you're going to tell the paths to the file containing the params. And here you specify if you want that the parameters of the sub-basin are read from the paths that you specified or not. So if you here specify the path to the params.csv and here you put overwrite, it means that the parameters are read from the dot the params under the .csv. Otherwise, the graph takes the params from the .sim. Is it clear or not? No. Okay. Again. If here I specify, for example, here, let's take one sub-basin, number one. Okay, our lovely number one. So here we specify that we want that the parameters of sub-basin number one are specified here in rem underscore params. And here we put overwrite. If here we delete this line and also this line, it means that the parameters of number one are those specified in one.sim. Okay? Mm-hmm. Okay.
If you have many ERM dot params file, it works.
Yes, yes.
And you can also calibrate them.
Yes, yes, yes. You can put, for example, seven sets of different parameters. If you calibrated each sub-basin separately, you can have at the maximum the seven sets of parameters.
And then Luca will ask the bug to the seven.
Yes. ERM. No, Luca, you have to run seven Luca calibrations. So you have just one path time in Luca.
So the parameters that you calibrate is specific just for the sub-basin,
yes,
where you specify, not for the up slope.
Yes, okay. If you want to do this kind of multi-site calibration, I will show you in the sim file here, okay. Here you put calibrate true if you are going to calibrate also considering that sub-basin. If you put calibrate false, it means that Luca is calibrating not considering that sub-basin. So you are basically fixing the parameters of this of this sub-basin and you are calibrating downstream. If I draw it. Okay, but I will show you a bit,
yes,
Luca.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
But remember the question.
Yes.
Okay. So now we see the SIM file, the three typology of SIM file. So basically the components here are the same, but here you can see that there are two additional components, which are out this one, X0 out mask, X0 out one storage. This is because we have to specify the fluxes, the out fluxes and the in fluxes for each node, and these are the components that deals with this part. So here the components are exactly the same that I shown you in 1_out. So we have the reader of precipitation, the rain snow separation, the reader of shortwave, the reader of temperature, snow, and so on. Okay. The connections are the same, but here, so now we are considering an external node. So for example, number 6, number 1, and number 7. So being an external node, there are just the out fluxes from this node. No one is going inside. So you have to specify out fluxes. And these are not connections. You are simply saying that these are the out fluxes. Okay, when you are instead you are considering the node number 2, you have both influxes and outfluxes. So when you have influxes here, you have to specify which are the nodes that are flowing into your node. So for example, here we are in node number 2, and we have 1 and 6. Here there are 4 specifications. Why? Because you are propagating the discharge from number 1, so it's the output of Muskingum, the discharge from number 6, so it's the output from Muskingum, and then we want also to store the information about the storage. Okay, so the difference between the discharge and the storage is that the discharge is aggregating through the network. So at your closed section you have one time series with the discharge, while the storage you have to keep this information. So at the end, I will show you, you will have a file in which each column is associated to a subbasin, and you have the time variation of the storage for that subbasin. Okay, is it clear? Okay, that's why you have 4 influxes here. And then you have the outfluxes, which are exactly the same of the external nodes 6, 1, and 7.
But in principle, you can have the discharges in any node.
Yes, if you want, you can have the discharge in any node. You have just to insert the writer, as in the other SIM file. So you put the writer and you write the output from each node. So if you want to see what is going on in each node, you add the component for the writer. Otherwise, you see at the end of the sum of all these charges propagated, of course. And then we have the node number 4, which is the last node, which we don't have outfluxes because it's the closer. But we have the influxes. In this case, we have the influxes only from node number 3. So here we have just 2 entries. 3, the output from Muskingum and the information on the storage. Okay. Okay, this is okay, before going to the DAM, let's have a look to the SIM file that I prepared for you. Okay, I will as I said, node number 1, node number 6, and node number 7 are external nodes. So, if we go at line here, for example, okay, 192, we have the optofluxes, only the optofluxes. So for simfile 1, 6, and 7, at the end we have just the optofluxes, which are the maskingum, so the discharge, output of maskingum, and the information on the storage. Then we go to simfile 2. Okay, this means, according to the graph, this means that potentially, if you have a good computer, you can run in parallel node number 1, node number 7, and node number 6. Because they are independent nodes and they can be processed in parallel. Then we have node number 2. In node number 2, if we look at the influxes, we have the influxes from node number 1 and 6, both for the discharge and for the storage. And then we have the outfluxes. The outfluxes that are going to node number 3.
Is it possible to know a priori how many in-node components we have to instance?
Because here you have just four,
but this depends on
You have to look at your topology file. If you look at your topology file,
the graph, as soon as it's a directed acyclic graph, it works. You can have even multiple exits.
Yes, you can have a situation like this, and then you have six, because two.
But if it's going to be to loop.
Yeah, I understand this.
If you cannot have loops.
Yeah.
But as soon as you have a different direction, you can also split, and they can rejoin.
Yes,
below.
So the information that you are propagating along the network is the discharge that is going like this. So you know the discharge you are summing, so basically. Okay, but then the storage is an information that is based in a specific. So for each of these, you have your time series of storage that is going something like this.
What would happen, for example, if from 3 you have an outflow and that outflow then is connected to 4 or 2? Do you have that?
No, okay.
For example, in node 3, if
okay.
You have an outflow.
Here, something that is going
Okay. And then somehow it gets reconnected to 4 later on. Is that possible?
Yes, you have to insert a new node here.
Yeah, of course.
Number 10. And then you have to reconnect.
Okay,
yes.
So that loop, that
yes.
Tiny loop
yes.
Is possible.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
So you have basically to add the nodes to your graph. You can do also something like this if you want.
No, that you cannot. Because you have a loop. Because you have 3 to 4, 4 to 10, and 10 to 3, that's a loop.
That's a loop, but it works for not in a river, but for example in hydraulic construction, if you have
you have in reality, but it cannot work on the
yeah.
Net3.
Ah, okay.
But
there is a numerical problem in solving this,
okay.
Because whenever you have a direct acyclic graph, you can decompose the solving sequentially. And separate some of the sequentially along the graph and separate the nodes that are not connected. If you have a loop, you have to iterate the solution of the system through all the time and you have to solve all together.
Okay.
I can show you a paper of from this point of view. We have in our last paper actually a comment on this. But the comment in the paper was related to other things, but the paper that we are citing is applicable to the...
They are not independent.
Yes.
I have a very last one. Inval 1 is because there is also inval 2, 3, and 4?
No.
So it's just...
it's a name. Okay.
And this depends on the graph, not on the component.
No, this is an entry. Yes, that is a component.
Which is in GeoFrame?
Which is here in the project. There are a part of the components that you can put within the project. Okay, is in. Let me remember. Okay, here are all the classes that we made for the graph that are managed by the.
Okay, and this is in the project in GeoFrame GitHub X0. All the building, all the source code for building is.
Yeah, there are all the source code.
Okay.
Yes. That we implemented are not on GitHub in the GeoFrame component. These are in the project. Are in the project. We can put there. There are also in the partials. This is basically set in the code because it's a method. This is a Java problem. But in Node 1, in Node 2 is the name of your class that you are associating here.
No, it's that X0 we never
because X0 are here in this part. Subfolder of the project are the components that are included in OMS, directly in OMS. But I think that we can do a job. Never tried. Okay, so this is number 2. And then we have number 3, which is the same of number 2. So in this case, we have the influx is arriving from number 2 and number 7, again for the storage, the same outfluxes. And then we have node number 4, which we have only the influxes. If we want to close our river at section number 5, I put also here the number 5. We have the influxes from number 4 and the outfluxes, actually, no outfluxes should be here. This is an error. Okay. This is a little bit tricky, but it's easy. You know, just to put a little bit of attention. Okay. Okay, in theory, I put here also the sync file for the DAM, if there is anyone interested in. Okay, so for example, let's imagine that we are going to put DAM in the node number 3. So here we have an additional information which are the outflows from the dam. Here I called it erogazioni Enel. So the outflows should be measured, so someone has to tell you if something is going out from the dam, otherwise no. The component for the dam is here, dam modeling dot water budget dam. And then we have the same input and output. Let's go here. Okay, so the influxes are the same because are arriving number 2 and number 7 to number 3, and the outfluxes are the same. So you are basically changing the core of the component. here in the parameter part, and you're adding the component of the DAM, but the connections are the same. Okay. So as regards the DAM, important here is for the DAM modeling are all these parameters, which are the parameters related to the speedway. So for example, the initial condition, okay, so there are the H sphero, actually is in Italian, I should replace it with the English version. So is the stage at which the speedway activates.
You can draw a little bit a drawing the, to show what the speedway is.
Okay, let's start with the surface and the surface. So you have the surface of the dam, of course, is changing with the stage, which is within the dam. So in this simplified model, we imagine that there is a linear relationship between the surface and the stage. How we obtain this linear relationship? So you know from the data of the DAM, there are the stage and the area at the, that's critical for me because I don't know the English term for the DAM. So we have the maximum stage, massimo invaso, massima regolazione, I don't know in English,
maximum
regulation, maximum level, so these are the data that are given for each DAM. So you know that the stage at maximum level, at maximum regulation, and from this data you derive your relationship between the area and the stage. And these are the coefficient and the intercept, A and B. Then there is the initial condition, so it's basically the stage within the DAM at the initial of your simulation period. Then you have the stage at which the spillway activates. So here imagine that you have your spillway, this is the stage. At which your spillway, so if you are here, you don't have, the spillway doesn't activate. Otherwise, here you have your outflow from the, and then to in the that table that I showed you this morning, there are the equation for the speedway. This one, in which L is the. In which L is the length of the spillway, and H is the stage, and U is another parameter. Okay. And all these parameters are given for the DAM, so you should know which is the length of your spillway, which is the H at which the spillway activates, and so on. And then here I made a mistake. Outflows and erogazioni L should be the same file. Okay. I completely forgot to translate this one in outflows, but these two are the same.
Obviously, this data is not the true one.
No, this data is not the true one. I try to use the data of the scene with the Kao networks, but of course, the results are just a try. So, okay, this is the same file. Okay, now, so we can try to run a simulation using the graph to see if everything is working, and then we can try to change the parameters. Previously, we changed the parameters within the sim file. Now, you can try to change the parameters from the parameter sim file. I will open it right now just to show you in real time how is okay. Okay. one, the one that I was showing you. So these are the parameters of the snow, rain snow separation, snow component, canopy, root zone, runoff, groundwater, and masking are exactly the same that I showed you this morning.
Can you put comments on the parameters file?
Yes.
The previous one?
Always //.
So you can put //. This is okay. This is groundwater. This is okay.
I can do this. Just to to have.
You don't have to do that now, but.
No. Okay. Just to help you, I put here everything. But I can put the comments. So now you can try to open the graph .sim, and you can try to first of all run graph.sim and then open the params CSV and change the params and see the difference, what is going on, and also open the two files, discharge and storage, and see the difference that I was saying, that there is just one column for discharge and 7 columns for the storage.
And this will work because all the SIM file has calibrated was true, otherwise.
Okay, calibrate true is not giving an information to the graph, because calibrate true is only for Luca.
Okay.
Instead, the parameter on the right is for the graph.
Did you run the simulation? Did you run the simulation? No.
Okay. So it was not to the right in the flags, it didn't change from the graph. It didn't change the value that we assigned in the parameter.
So just try to run. Yeah, I think that you will have the same error before that you had before, because the Windows and Mac, but there will be. Okay, so this is going. So for example, here is telling you how many nodes in parallel are is processing. So for example, here is processing simultaneously 1, 7, and 6. Here, prints out the parameters we are using. So for example, here you can see that he's using the parameters that are specified here in data, Ravona. So for example, here you can see that A is equal to 0.18, and here it is A 0.18. Now it's processing HRDO number 2, number 3, and number 4, and so then if you go to output Cavone, you have storage 4 and hydro 4. I move it to the test editor and you can see what I was saying before. You kept the information for each sub-basin, so this is the time variation of the storage.
Could you transfer another folder for this data? Yes, but if you have got...
While for the hydrograph, we have just one value.
The same,
one column, which is the hydrograph, the protein section number 4. Okay, and then
you want the hydrograph in the other basin. So basically you have to create a writer module in the same file.
So you, if you want to print the discharge for each sub-basin, you go within HC file, you have here the component, the writer component, so writer discharge, and you instantiate the writer. Here you put the parameter of the writer, which is the path, the step, and the other parameters that we saw this morning. And here you put the connection, you want to print the discharge, so you have to put mask out to mask, writer in data, and you print the discharge for each did it work? Yes? Okay. So, now for example,
copy again, probably because of the net sum to
put it
here.
Are you sure that we use the same formula?
Okay, so here, for example, I'm interested in seeing how the storage in the root zone is varying.
Okay.
So since the storage is varying for each you have for each column, so we have number one, instead of the variation is number one and number
six.
And what are the measured units?
Okay, so here are millimeters, so the storage is measured in millimeters, and discharge is a cubic meter per second.
Is this the state variable of the reservoir?
For each of the for each in the root zone. If you want to see the groundwater, you print the groundwater.
And how to pass from here to the, let's say, content of water in the root zone?
This is the storage, the actual storage.
Is the content of water?
Is the content of water? Yes.
In millimeters.
But it's similar to the dimension of the column that we have computed at all.
Exactly. It's the, what we call the saturation. Because you see, if you divide for the maximum storage, you have a degree of saturation degree between 0 and 1. In the room zone.
Cubic meter per second?
Yes, in the discharge. Okay. What we can, what you can do if you want, is open. Please open the parameters with the RM parameters, ERM parameters, and try to change the parameters. So you can see the difference in the discharge, changing the parameters for the whole. River. Of course, okay, we will discuss more about all these aspects in the calibration. Okay, these are, those are the parameters that we calibrated for the, again, for Basilicata case study. This set of parameters was obtained keeping fixed a part of this parameter, just calibrating the part of the range for runoff. So we set the literature value for with UC alpha R and alpha S 1 equal to 1 and so on, because those are fixed literature values, but you can calibrate also all the parameters.
To read this in not ecological, but today some files that have something like read time series and write time series, don't I use to read this and get a data frame?
It's in Kafon.
Yeah, all these kind of files that they have this add plus T table.
Yes, 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 it's always the same.
So always that's in a function.
Yes, yes. Because
there
is the same
input,
the data structure is the same.
But for the parameter, we have a legend or something like that in order to see more or less what we can modify.
Yes, I will show you in Luca. There are we are going to do a discussion about the parameters.
Yes.
This small exercises
yes,
in which I'm
I
asking you to run the model is to do a sort of handmade sensitivity analysis,
okay,
which is customized on your case study. So I will show you in Luca there are the range of variation of these parameters. I already tried to do some simulation, varying and seeing if the storage is going to zero, how the other is changing. So this is something that you have to do before, just to understand how your the behavior of your system, and then you can put the range of your calibration.
Yeah. Okay. We have a legend which is named the significant alarm.
Ah, yes, yes, of course. Everything is reported in the first block of the slide.
Okay.
Are exactly the same name of the parameter.
Okay,
so,
okay,
for example, let's do something like this. Okay. So let's see here. A and B are coefficients of the nonlinear reservoir. Here are exactly PP soil. Where is PP soil?
It's the B of.
No. It's okay, because I didn't report the question, but it's this one. And then there are the parameters of the... everything is okay.
Okay.
I try to maintain coherence, more or less. Okay. So if you played a little bit with your parameter for the next 10 minutes, then we go to Luca calibration and we
good. Other questions?